Good morning, everyone. And welcome to Emmanuel Lutheran Church. And thank you for being here this morning as we gather to worship our Lord. I'm Pastor Stephen. And you probably noticed that in the last week or so, there's been quite a bit of controversy in the news regarding the Olympics and the opening ceremony and the Lord's Supper. Today, we're going to be looking at that from a Christian perspective and remembering just exactly what a blessing the Lord's Supper actually is. That it is Jesus' body and blood shed on the cross for our forgiveness and risen from the dead, and then given to us that we may live forever in him. It is truly a sacred and holy and heavenly thing, and we thank our Lord Jesus for that gift. May our worship today be glorifying to God and a blessing to you. Amen. Our welcoming hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Please rise. Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We pause to reflect on our sins and the forgiveness we're promised in our Savior Jesus. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sin. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Since we have received the forgiveness of Christ, we share with one another the peace of Christ. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, though we do not deserve your goodness, still you provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may acknowledge your gifts, give thanks for all your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. A reading from Exodus chapter 16. They set out for Elim, and all the congregation of people of Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai. On the 15th day of the second month after they had departed from the land of Egypt, and the whole congregation of the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the people of Israel said to them, "Would that we have died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by meat pots and ate breads to the full. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I am about to rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather the day's proportion every day, that I may test them whether they will walk in my law or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather daily." So Moses and Aaron said to all the people of Israel, "At evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt, and in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your grumbling against the Lord. For what are we that you grumble against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you in the evening meat to eat, and in the morning bread to the full, because the Lord has heard your grumbling that you grumbled against him, what are we? Your grumbling is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, come near before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling." And as soon as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in a cloud. And the Lord said to Moses, "I have heard the grumbling of the people of Israel. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall be filled with bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. In the evening quail came up and covered the camp, and in the morning dew lay around the camp. And when the dew has gone up, there was on the face of the wilderness a fine flake-like thing, fine as frost on the ground. When the people of Israel saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Gather of it each of you as much as you can eat. You shall each take an omer, according to the number of persons that each of you has in his tent.' And the people of Israel did so. They gathered some more, some less. But when they measured it was an omer. Whoever gathered much had nothing left over, and whoever gathered little had no lack. Each of them gathered as much as he could eat. And Moses said to them, "Let no one leave any of it over till the morning." But they did not listen to Moses. Some left part of it till the morning, and it bred worms and stank. And Moses was angry with them. Morning by morning they gathered it, each as much as he could eat. But when the sun grew hot, it melted. This is the word of our Lord. The second lesson, a reading from Ephesians chapter 2. Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcised by what is called circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinance, that he might create in himself one new man in place of two. So by making peace and making reconciliation us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him we have both access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows in a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together in a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. This is the word of our Lord.
Please rise for the Alleluia verse. Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter. On the next day, the crowd that remained on the other side of the sea saw that there had been only one boat there, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Other boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum, seeking Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "Then what sign do you do, that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, He gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus then said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God the Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our sermon texts for this week come from Exodus 16 and the Gospel of John chapter 6, as just read. Thus, in this week's sermon, let's reflect on the true bread of heaven and Jesus' sacred gift of body and blood for our forgiveness in the Lord's eternal supper. As by now I'm sure you're well aware, many people around the world found the opening ceremony of this year's Olympic Games to be a little strange. Apparently, the organizers' goal was to promote inclusivity and universal unity. But unfortunately, the global televised display, including talking beheaded royalty, dancing drag queens gathered around a table evoking the image of Jesus Christ and his disciples represented in Leonardo da Vinci's painting of the Last Supper in the minds of many, if not simply a rainbow-colored pagan feast, and a scantily clad blue man served on a silver platter singing a French song about being naked, instead seemed to cause only more confusion and division among people of all nations, spanning all ages, professing many different religions, than the global celebration and unity that was officially intended. Of course, plenty of people really liked it and praised it, including celebrities and politicians and the news media, and millions of citizens with the values that aligned with their own, unapologetically signaled by all of the imagery. Many others were simply just confused, and naturally countless parents and Christians, among followers of other faiths, were offended and found the show inappropriate for children, if not a blatant display of virtue signaling and blasphemous parody of the sacred symbol, specifically the Lord's Supper, Jesus' body and blood for the forgiveness of sins. And I'm certain that many of you here today may have felt the same way, since many of you told me specifically this week. And I agree that the Olympics opening ceremony certainly wasn't anything worth celebrating or even condoning. Nor was it all that inspired, revolutionary, or all that shocking. Whether it was simply intended to be a pagan feast celebrating the Greek god of wine, Dionysus, and the LGBTQIA plus ideology, or a subtle jab at the famous image of Jesus representing the increasingly unpopular sacred doctrine and faith that is Christianity, at the end of the day, it was still just the same brave, secular stance and virtue signaling we see broadcast on every single channel, every hour of every day. In fact, when I had first heard about it from my wife, my initial reaction was, that's interesting. And that's because it immediately reminded me of something I'd written for a sermon on the blessing of marriage over 3 years ago. It was an illustration that I had decided to cut from my final draft for time, as writers must, and because I thought, well, we're not quite there yet. Funny enough, I was able to find it on an old flash drive, and I think it's quite fitting. So I'd like to read it for you now for the first time as the second section of this sermon. Here it goes. The eternal truth of God's holy will, law, and gospel for us are not a buffet for our picking and choosing. And though Satan may buffet, the daily bread of heaven, his uniting word of life, is sufficient to strengthen against temptation, satisfy our hunger and thirst for true forgiveness, and sustain all in saving faith for eternal communion with him. Likewise, Christ's loving institutions for us earthly men and women, like Eden's marriage union, and his blessed sacraments for forgiven saints of heaven of baptism and holy communion, are truly complete and surely enough. They need no mortal beefing, buffing, or touching up. Christ's wedding portrait doesn't need a new time frame. And the Eucharist, our Lord's divine supper, requires no more nor less ingredients. This image of man and woman made one in love is the one Christ presented to his believing wedded bride. And the consecrated marriage feast he's given of his own flesh and blood is the faithful consummation of eternal communion between Jesus and his redeemed beloved body, the church. They're already exactly what our wise and merciful God intended, and our sinful changes could only take away from his work's perfection. For instance, imagine I took one of Leonardo da Vinci's masterpieces, like The Last Supper, and decided to update it and make it more modern and relevant by adding a few adjustments according to my personal preferences. Maybe I like the welcoming theme of sharing and unity, which Leonardo's painting depicting the historic moment Jesus instituted the blessing of the Holy Communion does beautifully. But maybe I decide to update the attire of those at the table. And while I'm at it, maybe I diversify the dinner guests for a more inclusive cast of recipients. I like the visual symmetry of six people all whispering to each other with their arm around one another on both sides of the table and one person in the middle. But maybe instead of 12 disciples, I decide to paint them as couples. So on the left side, perhaps I paint two gay cisgender males in a monogamous relationship and two lesbian cisgender females in a consensually non-monogamous relationship, and a bisexual cisgender male with a polysexual bigender individual in an emotionally committed yet sexually curious relationship. And on the right, maybe a pansexual cisgender drag queen, a bisexual transgender female, and an omnisexual gender fluid individual in an emotionally monogamous yet sexually open polyamorous relationship. Oh yeah, and a straight cisgender male and female in a monogamous relationship, just to preserve the traditional feeling of Da Vinci's original work. And with one spot left, I suppose I'll add an asexual agender person. Of course, the Lord's Supper is a pretty exclusively religious thing. So maybe I'll just change that bread and wine, or body and blood, as some Christians believe, Jesus is offering to a more unifying, yet still loving gift for everyone, like marriage certificates. In which case, I'll have a few of those couples starting to walk away from the table, since after all, just because two people are sleeping or living together doesn't mean that they want or have to get married, and no need to add kids to the mix, since they'll only complicate things. Not to mention my hands starting to get tired from all of this repainting. Now it's coming along, but there's still just one problem. Having Jesus center stage like that, looking all holy and handing out marriage certificates as if he's in control of officiating this basic human right, is pretty problematic and frankly reeks of religious dominance, the patriarchy, and toxic masculinity. So maybe we'll just paint over Christ entirely and replace him with Aphrodite, or better yet, Lady Liberty. Ah, much better. Now that's a unifying message for the 21st century. Of course, I can no longer call it the Last Supper. Due to the changes I've made, it's far from the same. It's no longer historically accurate. It has a completely different meaning. It's a different thing entirely. And its creator, Leonardo da Vinci, certainly wouldn't want his name anywhere near it. He wouldn't want credit for what it's become because of what I've done. He wouldn't see any of my revisions as improvements, but rather vandalism of his original offering. He'd simply say, that wasn't my vision. That was not my intent. It's not my work. Since I've changed the context of the event, the gift, the giver, and the recipients, it's simply a rejection of the source's message and a corruption of my own creation. It may make me happy, but certainly not Da Vinci, not to mention his inspiration, Jesus Christ. There's a reason we don't use Jack Daniels and cotton candy for the Lord's Supper. Because if we did, it wouldn't be his. We wouldn't be receiving Christ's body and blood. It would no longer be the heavenly blessing and meal instituted by Jesus for our forgiveness. It would just be junk food with a side shot of blasphemy. In fact, it would be severely, spiritually unhealthy, because the elements are important and God's word is essential. If we change either, it's not truly communion. There's no real fellowship. It's no more his intended blessing. Just as marriage requires a man and a woman, so also does the Lord's Supper require bread and wine with Jesus' body and blood to eat and to drink in faith for forgiveness. Drats. Aphrodite. Now, if I had just written Dionysus, that would have been a pretty impressive, predictive illustration. Still, it was pretty close, which just goes to show that whenever it comes to our culture, whatever's strange today will be here to stay tomorrow. However, Christians can take a joke, even if we don't think it's funny. We can endure mockery and parody, even vitriol and blasphemy, because we know our Lord is almighty. The truth doesn't change from day to day. That faith in the grace of his body and blood is eternally strong, and that absolutely nothing in this world can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. As Jesus said to the crowd seeking a lasting sign in our gospel lesson from John chapter 6, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Meaning, even if some artistic activists decided to paint over every single depiction of the Last Supper in the world out of disdain for the Lord's Supper, it wouldn't change the meal. Would we still not have the real deal? Christ's own body and blood and bread and wine for our forgiveness? Communion would still be had. The Eucharist would still be celebrated. And Jesus would still be truly present among us in body and soul. The world can do what it wants. It will. And as it does, the truth and beauty of God's love and forgiveness will continue to be mocked. Yet it will never be lost. All our God has done, all people whom he's bought and strengthened with his body and blood shall abide forever by grace through faith. Lots of things on earth can be forsaken by man, but nothing can forsake and shake God's forgiveness and salvation for all men and women who believe in him, which is why we've been called to continue to run the race, not panic and lose our cool over every little thing. Stand strong in the eternal word of God and speak the truth in love to everyone who is willing to hear it, those with us and those against us, that the Holy Spirit may sprout the seed of faith within, and even more people than watch the Olympics may be granted the only reward that truly lasts forever and live to win heaven. The chalice shared and passed at the Lord's Supper is a sacred symbol because it causes us to remember his Last Supper, his crucifixion on the cross, his resurrection from the grave, his body and blood for our forgiveness, and the feast of the Lamb that awaits us in his heavenly presence. Whenever we partake of the Lord's Supper, we are doing it in remembrance of Christ's passion and the sacred benefits that we receive in taking and eating and drinking in belief is in fact his own body and blood for us. If it wasn't Jesus' flesh and blood for true forgiveness, he wouldn't have said it was. We don't come to the Lord's altar at his table to feel forgiven, but to be forgiven. Our Lord's invitation to Holy Communion is without a doubt the closest men and women like you and I will ever be to heaven until the day that only God knows that we actually enter it. Indeed, Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper is a beautiful work of art, but the Lord's Supper is the beautiful work of Christ, the gift of salvation, God's own flesh and blood shed on the cross and given unto us for eternal redemption. The vessels are beautiful reminders, but the saving substance they bear is sacred. Yes, it can be seen and felt and heard and smelt and poured and snapped and chewed and drank. That's why it's called a sacrament. The earthly elements are the means by which God's spiritual blessings are bestowed unto us. And it is miraculous. It's a holy, sacred, heavenly thing. Thanks be to Jesus. The only reason our culture mocks it, and many Christians have demoted it into something lesser, in many denominations, nothing more than a digestible gesture or favor to God reserved for special occasions, and a symbolic snack time of crackers and juice, is for the sake of earthly reason and logic. After all, how could God Almighty, the Creator, Savior, and eternal ruler of heaven and earth, who came into the world, entered flesh, and was made man, was crucified, died, and was buried in flesh and blood for the forgiveness of sins, who rose from the grave and ascended into heaven in body and soul, and has sent his Holy Spirit to dwell within us as his own, possibly truly be present in the sacraments he himself established and commanded us to cherish? I mean, how could the living word of God really be present when God's word is spoken in the waters of holy baptism in the name of the Father and of the Son and in the Holy Spirit, or in, with, and under the bread and wine Christ said was his body and blood? For if that was the case, the bread of heaven would have to be abundant enough to feed thousands or millions, and one would have to be omnipotent to feed a crowd that big. Furthermore, Christians of every nation celebrate the Lord's Supper around the world, meaning the blood of Christ, the wine of the true vine, would have to be everywhere those who hunger and thirst for righteousness are worshiping, wherever two or three are gathered in his name. What is he, omnipresent or something? I suppose God could hear and answer the prayers of every single person who cries out to him in faith too, huh? You see how blasphemous the modern argument for symbolic communion sounds when actually spoken out loud? How vapid and empty Christ's words of institution appear when misinterpreted by deaf and doubting ears? How spiritually harmful and poisonous this healing feast can become to all who eat and drink of it in an unworthy manner. As we read in our Old Testament lesson, after God blessed his people with bread from heaven, Moses said to them, "Let no one leave any of it till the morning." But they did not listen to Moses. Some of them left it until the morning, and it bred worms and stank. Therefore, we remember that the Eucharist is not ours to change. Truly, truly, I say to you, our Lord meant what he said. Take, eat, this is my body. Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. And Christ desires us to do exactly that with faith in remembrance of him. For as it is written in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. Thus we come not in pride, self-righteousness, or a celebration of earthly sin, but in humility, repentance, and thanksgiving for Christ's sacrifice for our eternal redemption. Then in this sacred meal, we're sanctified, strengthened by the Holy Spirit that unites us to Christ himself as well as to one another. There's grave danger in confessing anything secular as sacred, but there's great blessing in keeping holy all that is sacred according to the true, unchanging word of Christ. Indeed, we ought certainly strive to respect God's sanctuary whenever we're gathered and honor the sacred space where he's promised to meet us with his means of grace. And so we do our best to strive to express our humble thanksgiving, our respectful traditions and the way that we conduct ourselves, bowing before his altar, kneeling at his table, standing in prayer. But this is done most reverently, simply by coming in faith. Based on God's nature as revealed in Holy Scripture, it's fair to say that the Lord looks much more favorably on the humble man who owns no nice clothes, joyfully brings a tithe of his hourly earnings, yawns the entire sermon because he works evenings, and never remembers to bow before communion, than the proud man who dresses solely and attends to impress, gives hoping to earn his say-so, bows only for show, and almost always leaves before communion if he decides to go to church and worship God at all. Just like our spiritual ancestors in the wilderness of sin, we too are capable of turning even God's sacred institutions and blessed traditions into personal idols or blasphemous practices by our now nourished trust, sinful desires, and disobedience in the flesh. As it is written, "For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual impurity, theft, false witness, slander." However, God's grace, including his Holy Supper, are offered for exactly this purpose, to mercifully refresh us through this salutary gift and strengthen our faith in love in Jesus Christ. We eat and drink according to God's word and according to our need, which is why we need to eat and drink every week. We need our Lord's forgiveness, and mercifully, that's exactly what he serves us. The elements of bread and wine are essential, but the saving substance of body and blood in them are eternal. Thus, may we never partake in doubting, mocking, or changing it, nor forsake to joyfully celebrate it in forgiveness whenever we are gathered here together in faithful worship. The Lord's Supper is heaven's feast, Christ's body and blood given for us and for our salvation both now and forever. So believe, eat, and drink, In the holy name of Jesus, amen. We now join in confessing our faith together by reciting the Apostles' Creed. Please rise. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Gracious Heavenly Father, as you provided for the Israelites during their journey through the wilderness to the land you had promised, give us confidence to trust in you and to look at your hand, provide all we need for this life and for life to come. Lord, in your mercy. Holy One, your Son gives us the office of ministry, that your people might be equipped to serve and be built up in his one body. Remember in your compassion all who speak your word. Give them faithfulness and honesty in their teaching, that your children will be freed from all deceit to speak your truth to one another in love, growing up in every way into Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, grant us true unity in the faith. Preserve us in pure doctrine. Grant harmony in our congregation, district, and synod. And bestow on us charitable hearts that put the best construction on what we see and hear. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God and Father of all, enable us to walk in humility, gentleness, and patience, that we may bear with one another in love and be eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Mighty One, you establish civil government to be a blessing. To your mercy, then we commend Joseph, our President, our Congress, our justices and magistrates, and all who serve the public in any way. Keep them honest, fill them with wisdom, and uphold them in every good deed. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Show your mercy to the sick and hospitalized. Provide doctors and nurses and other medical professions to care for those who need health and healing. Especially prayers of comfort for the Mal family as they deal with Michael's death this past week. Prayers of healing for Wally struggling with kidney issues. Prayers of healing for Katie, Peggy, Fred, Dolores, Kathy, Diane, Marge, Dawn, Liz, Janet, Arthur, Samantha, Joe, Jamie, Alicia, Lance, Dottie, Kim, Gary, Marion, Bill, Ray, Doug, Wally, Raymond, Delaria, and Nancy, all who are being treated for cancer. Prayers for Paul, Jennifer, Dylan, Diane, Dennis, Lewis, and Jake. Lord, in your mercy. Loving Father, you have provided manna for your ancient people to sustain them in the wilderness. By your grace, you provided the living bread from heaven and the very body of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, that endured to eternal life. Help us to approach your table with thankful and contrite hearts, that we might receive your Son's precious body and blood for the forgiveness of all our sins. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we come as people tossed to and fro by the manifold changes of this mortal life. Help us to know in you that which is eternal. Give us confidence in the suffering and death of Christ, that we may rejoice that you are with us always and await his joyous appearance with all the saints. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated. Just a reminder, you should all have received a worship fellowship card when you came in. Please take a moment to fill it out. And more importantly, in the back, if you have any prayers, concerns, or Thanksgiving you want to offer, please place them back there. And Wednesday, the pastor and the elders, we get together and we will go over them. We continue with our offerings.
Please rise for the offertory. Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We continue with the Agnus Dei.
Thank you.
cry out to Him.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith towards you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Just one quick thing before our sending hymn. As our world continues to get crazier and online and social media gets more and more poisonous, remember the blessing that you have in the forgiveness of Jesus Christ and the certainty of salvation. Be lights in the world. And when you don't know what to say, simply share a scripture verse. For that is indeed the truth in love. Our sending hymn, sent forth by God's blessing.
Thank you.
Thanks be to God.